हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, आई एम डॉक्टर हिमांशु अरोड़ा फ्रॉम डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ एंथ्रोपोलॉजी, यूनिवर्सिटी ऑफ दिल्ली. टुडे आई एम गोइंग टू स्पीक ऑन द मॉड्यूल प्रोग्रेस एंड डेवलपमेंट इन एंथ्रोपोलॉजी फ्रॉम द पेपर अप्लाइड एंथ्रोपोलॉजी. द लर्निंग ऑब्जेक्टिव ऑफ दिस मॉड्यूल आर टू नो अबाउट द हिस्ट्री एंड पाथ ब्रेकिंग कॉन्ट्रीब्यूशन ऑफ डिफरेंट एमिनेंट कॉन्ट्रीब्यूटर्स अराउंड द वर्ल्ड. टू स्टडी द क्रोनोलॉजिकली अरेंज डिफरेंट माइलस्टोन इवेंट्स अराउंड द वर्ल्ड that explain the development of the discipline, to identify few path-breaking publications that direct the future pathway of the anthropological research and development, and lastly, to have an insight of brief history and progress of anthropological theory. Let's start with a brief introduction to the history of anthropology. As we know that history of anthropology refers primarily to the 18th and 19th century precursors of modern anthropology. The development of the anthropological thought has sprung in the 19th century with the Enlightenment theory of philosophical rationalism. Through a logical interpretive endeavor, phylogenetically, man's rationality followed an inevitable development as a byproduct of continuous biological and cultural evolutionary processes. The development of different school of thought along with different time and space thoroughly explained in the following sections. Now, let's talk about the history and path-breaking contribution of different eminent contributors around the world. The term anthropology itself innovated as a new Latin scientific word during the Renaissance and has always meant the study or science of man. The topics to be included and the terminology has varied historically. Marvin Harris, a historian of anthropology, begins that the rise of anthropological theory with the statement that anthropology is the science of history. He is not suggesting that history be renamed to anthropology, or that there is no distinction between history and prehistory, or that anthropology excludes current social practices as the general meaning of history, which it has in History of Anthropology would seem to imply. As one of the founders of cultural anthropology, Harris used the term history in a special sense. He used it as the natural history of society, in the words of Herbert Spencer, or the universal history of mankind. According to Harris, the 19th century anthropologists were theorizing under the presumption that the development of society followed some sort of laws. He decries the laws of that view in the 20th century by the denial that any laws are discernible or that current institutions have any bearing on the ancient. He coins the term ideographic for them. He also borrows the term from linguistics, just as phonetic system, which is a description of sounds developed without regard to the meaning and structure of the language, while a phonemic system describes the meaningful sounds actually used within the language. So anthropological data can be emic and etic. He makes a further distinction between synchronic and diachronic. Synchronic means same time, with reference to anthropological data is contemporaneous and cross-cultural. Diachronic, through time. Data shows that the development of lines through time. Cultural materialism being a processually holistic and globally comparative scientific research strategy must depend for accuracy on all four types of data. It took Immanuel Kant 25 years to write one of the first major treatises on anthropology. Anthropology, from a pragmatic point of view, which treats it as a branch of philosophy. Kant is not generally considered to be a modern anthropologist, as he never left his region of Germany, nor did he study any culture beside his own. He did, however, begin teaching an annual course in anthropology in 1772. After discussing the history, let's talk about the national anthropological traditions. As academic discipline began to differentiate over the course of the 19th century, anthropology grew increasingly distinct from the biological approach of natural history on the one hand and from purely historical or literary field such as classics on the other. For instance, museums such as British Museum, which were not the only site of anthropological studies with the new imperialism period, Starting in the 1870s, zoos became unattended laboratories, especially the so-called ethnological exhibitions or Negro villages. The savages from the colonies were displayed often nude in cages in what has been called human zoos. Edward Brunner Tyler and James George Fraser are generally considered the antecedents to modern social anthropology in Britain. Although Tyler undertook a field trip to Mexico, but he and Fraser derived most of the material for their comparative studies through extensive reading, not field work. Mainly the classics, literature and history of Greece and Rome. The work of the early European folklorists and reports from the missionaries, travelers and contemporaneous ethnologists. Tyler advocated strongly for the unilism and a form of uniformity of mankind. Tyler in particular laid the groundwork for theories of cultural diffusionism, stating that there are three ways that different groups can have similar cultural forms or technologies: independent invention, inheritance from ancestors in a distant region, transmission from one race to another. Tyler also formulated one of the early and influential anthropological conceptions of culture as that complex whole, which includes knowledge, belief, art, morals, law, custom, and any other capabilities and habits acquired by humans as members of society. Fraser, a Scottish scholar with a broad knowledge of classics, also concerned himself with religion, myth, and magic. His comparative studies, most influentially in the numerous editions of the Golden Bough, analyzed similarities in the religious beliefs and symbolism globally. Bronislaw Malinowski and the British School. Towards the turn of the 20th century, a number of anthropologists became dissatisfied with his categorization of cultural elements. Historical reconstructions also came to seem increasingly speculative to them. Under the influence of several younger scholars, a new approach came to predominate among British anthropologists, concerned with analyzing how society is held together in the present, synchronic analysis rather than diachronic or historical analysis, and emphasizing long-term, 1 to several years, immersion fieldwork. He made use of the time by undertaking far more intensive fieldwork than had been done by British anthropologists and his classic ethnography. Agronauts of the Western Pacific advocated an approach to fieldwork that became standard in the field, getting the native's point of view through participant observation. Again, A.R. Radcliffe Brown also published a seminal work in 1922. He had carried out his initial fieldwork in the Andaman Islands in the old style of historical reconstruction. However, after reading the work of French sociologist Emile Durkheim and Marcel Mauss, Radcliffe Brown published an account of his research that paid close attention to the meaning and purpose of rituals and myths. Post-World War II, the trends in anthropology changed recurrently. Claude Lévi-Strauss helped institutionalize anthropology in France. Along with the enormous influence that his theory of structuralism exerted across multiple disciplines, Lévi-Strauss established ties with American and British anthropologists. At the same time, he established centers and laboratories within France to provide an institutional context within anthropology. While training influential students such as Maurice Gondelier and Francis Hereter, they proved influential in the world of French anthropology. Max Gluckman, together with many of his colleagues at the Rhodes Livingstone Institute and the students of Manchester University, collectively known as the Manchester School, took BSA in new directions through their introduction of explicitly Marxist-informed theory. Their emphasis on conflicts and conflict resolution and their attention to the ways in which individuals negotiate and make use of the social structural possibilities. In Britain, anthropology had a great intellectual impact. It contributed to the erosion of Christianity, the growth of cultural relativism, an awareness of the survival of the primitive in modern life, and the replacement of diachronic modes of analysis with synchronic, all of which are central to modern culture. In the United States, the trends in anthropology were not very different. From its beginning in the early 19th century through the early 20th century, anthropology in the United States were was influenced by the presence of Native American societies. Louis Henry Morgan, a lawyer from Rochester, New York, became an advocate for an ethnological scholar of the Iroquois. His comparative analysis of religion, government, material culture, and especially kinship pattern proved to be influential contribution to the field of anthropology. Also, Franz Boas established academic anthropology in the United States in opposition to his sort of evolutionary perspective. His approach was empirical, skeptical of overgeneralizations, and eschewed attempts to establish universal laws. For example, Boas studied immigrant children to demonstrate that biological race was not immutable and that human conduct and behavior resulted with nurture rather than nature. Influenced by the German tradition, Boas argued that the world was full of distinct cultures rather than societies whose evolution could be measured by how much or how little civilizations they had. He believed that each culture has to be studied in its particularity and argued that cross-cultural generalizations like those made in the natural sciences were not possible. Many American anthropologists adopted his agenda for social reform, and theories of race continue to be popular subjects for anthropologists today. The so-called four-field approach has its origin in Boasian anthropology, dividing the discipline in the four crucial and interrelated fields of sociocultural, biological, linguistic, and archaic anthropology. Anthropology in the United States continues to be deeply influenced by the Boasian tradition, especially its emphasis on culture. Now let's focus on the 20th century development in anthropological ideas and research. In the mid-20th century, American anthropology began to study its own history more systematically. In 1967, an American anthropologist, Marvin Harris, published The Rise of Anthropological Theory, presenting argumentative examination of anthropology's historical development, and George W. Stocking Jr. established the historicist school, examining the historical context of anthropological movements. After the publication of The Rise of Anthropological Theory in 1968, Harris helped focus the interest of anthropologists in cultural ecological relationships for the rest of his career. Many of his publications gained wide circulation among lay readers. In his final book, Theories of Culture in Postmodern Times, Harris argued that the political consequences of postmodern theory were harmful, a critique similar to those later developed by philosopher Richard Wallin and others. Now, as you can see in the table, a chronological arrangement of different milestone events around the world that explain anthropology as a discipline is given. Let's talk in detail. The foremost milestone in the table, as you can see, is in the year 1873. In this year, the American Museum of Natural History established an anthropology department. Similarly, in the year 1884, the Pitt River Museum was founded. In the year 1887, the University of Pennsylvania Museum of Archaeology and Anthropology is founded. While in the year 1898, the Cambridge Anthropological Expedition to the Torres Straits, in 1902, the American Anthropological Association is founded. In 1906, Anthropos General founded. In 1911, Ishii is discovered and taken to the Museum of Anthropology at the University of California. San Francisco, Ishii was the last known member of the Native American Yahi people from the state of California in the United States. In 1915, Bronislaw Malinowski began his studies in Trobriand Islands. In 1922, Nanook of the North is released in theaters. In 1924, Tong child fossil discovered. While in 1934, the Nihon Minzokokai, the Japanese Institute of Ethnology, is founded. In 1937, the Musée de Homme is founded. In the year 1940, the oldest known North American mummy, Spirit Caveman, is excavated. In 1949, two events took place. First was the discovery of the prehistoric paintings in Lesoque Caves, and second was the foundation of Human Relation Area Files, HRAF, at Yale University. Later in 1959, Mary Leakey discovered the first पेरेंथ्रोपस बोसाए क्रेनियम इन 1974, लूसी द फर्स्ट ऑस्ट्रेलोपिथिकस एफरेंसिस इज डिस्कवर्ड इन 1977, द कैनेडियन एथनोलॉजी एसोसिएशन, नाउ द कैनेडियन एंथ्रोपोलॉजी एसोसिएशन वॉज फाउंडेड एंड द फर्स्ट मार्गरेट मीड फिल्म फेस्टिवल वॉज हेल्ड इन 1984, टर्काना बॉय इज डिस्कवर्ड. टर्काना बॉय इज द कॉमन नेम ऑफ होमो इरेक्टस फॉसिल KNMWT 15,000, a nearly complete skeleton of a hominin youth who lived during the early Pleistocene. Later, in 1986, the Human Genome Project was launched, and in 1989, the National Museum of the American Indian is founded in the U.S. Similarly, you can see the various major findings in the field of anthropology in this table from the year 1873 to 2015. In the next table, you can see few path-breaking publications that direct the future pathway of the anthropological research and development from the year 1881 to 2012. Milestone in anthropology like Argonauts of the Western Pacific by Bronislaw Malinowski in the year 1922, Handbook of the Indians of California by Alfred Kroeber in 1925, Structure and Function in Primitive Society by Alfred Radcliffe Brown in 1935, Race, Language and Culture by Franz Boas in 1940, The Elementary Structures of Kinship by Claude Lévi-Strauss in 1949, Cows, Pigs, Warfare, Wars and Witches by Marvin Harris in 1974, and the latest one like Inclusive Humanism, Anthropological Basics for a Realistic Cosmopolitanism by Christopher Antiviller in 2011, and The Meaning of Freedom and Other Difficult Dialogues by Angela Davis in 2012 are given in this table. Now, after this, let's have a look on the brief history and progress of anthropological theory. Which aspects of life anthropologists concerns on usually reflects their theoretical orientation, subject interest, or preferred method of research? A theoretical orientation is usually a general attitude about how cultural phenomena are to be explained. Ideas about evolution took a long time to take hold because they contradicted the biblical view of events. Species were viewed as fixed in their form by the creator. But in the 18th and early 19th century, increasing evidence suggested that evolution was a viable theory. In geology, the concept of uniformitarianism suggested that the earth is constantly subject to shaping and reshaping by natural forces, working over vast stretches of time. The prevailing theoretical orientation in anthropology during the 19th century was based on a belief that culture generally evolves in a uniform and progressive manner. That is, most societies were believed to pass through the same series of stages to arrive ultimately at a common end. Two proponents of this early theory of cultural evolution were Edward Tylor and Lewis Henry Morgan. The diffusionist approach, popular in the late 19th and early 20th century, was developed by the two main schools, the British and the German-Austrian. In general, diffusionists believed that most aspects of high civilization had emerged in culture centers from which they then diffused outward. During the early 20th century, the leading opponent of evolutionism was Franz Boas, whose historical particularism rejected the way in which early evolutionists had assumed that universal laws governed all human cultures. Boas stressed the importance of collecting as much anthropological data as possible from which the laws governing cultural variation would supposedly emerge by themselves. The psychological orientation in anthropology, which began in 1920s, seeks to understand how psychological factors and processes may help us explain cultural practices. Functionalism in social science looks for the part that some aspect of culture or social life plays in maintaining a cultural system. There are two quite different looks of functionalism. Malinowski's version of functionalism assumed that all cultural traits serve the need of individuals in a society. Radcliffe Brown felt that the various aspects of social behavior maintain a society's social structure rather than satisfying individual needs. In the 1940s, Leslie A. White received the evolutionary approach to cultural development. White believed that technological development or the amount of energy harnessed per capita was the main driving force creating cultural evolution. Anthropologists such as Julian Steward, Marshall Salin, and Elman Service have also presented evolutionary viewpoints. Claude Lévi-Strauss has been the leading proponent of structuralism. Lévi-Strauss sees culture as it is expressed in art, ritual, and the pattern of daily life as a surface representation of the underlying patterns of the human mind. Whereas Lévi-Strauss' structuralist approach involves intuitively grasping the rules of the thought that may underlie a given culture, an ethnographic approach known as ethnoscience attempts to derive these rules from a logical analysis of data, particularly the words people use to describe their activities. Cognitive anthropology has its role in ethnoscience. Cultural ecology seeks to understand the relationships between cultures and their physical and social environments. Cultural ecologists ask how a particular culture traits may be adaptive in its environment. The theoretical orientation called political economy focuses on the impact of external political and economic processes, particularly as connected to colonialism and imperialism, on local events and cultures in the underdeveloped world. The political economy approach has reminded us that all parts of the world are interconnected for better or worse. Evolutionary ecology involves the application of biological evolutionary principles to the social behavior of animals, including humans. Feminist approach were born from the realization that the study of women and the women's role in other cultures are relatively rare. Some feminist anthropologists take an overtly political stance, seeing their task as identifying ways in which women are exploited and working to overcome them. Others simply try to understand women's lives and how they differ from those of them. For many interpretive anthropologists, the goal of anthropology is to understand that it means to be a person living in a particular culture rather than to explain what cultures vary. The task of understanding meaning, these scholars claim, cannot be achieved scientifically, but can only be approached through forms of literary analysis. Postmodernists take the interpretive idea that all knowledge is subjective, further arguing that knowledge is actively shaped by the political powers. There are various anthropological theories which had progressed over time. So the early anthropological theories includes early evolutionism, race theory and diffusionism, and the later anthropological theories include historical particularism, psychological approaches, functionalism, neo-evolutionism, structuralism, ethnoscience, and cognitive anthropology, cultural ecology, and political economy. While the recent development in anthropological theories include evolutionary ecology approaches, feminist approaches, interpretive approaches, postmodernist approach, and the pragmatic approach. After discussing broadly about the progress and development in anthropology, let's summarize the module. Evolutionism is often thought of as a 19th century theory, and it is not entirely unrelated to the commonplace idea of progress or to the notion of social development. Progress, in fact, was a very 19th century concept, and it is retained in our thinking today. The word development, with its present day meaning of helping out people in poorer countries to be economically at least more like people in richer countries, is only about 40 or 50 year old. Structuralism achieved greater notoriety thanks especially to the work of Lévi-Strauss, which was an influential well beyond the boundaries of anthropology. Evans, Pritchard, Needham, and Ardenner at Oxford built upon functionalism and structuralism while rejecting the analogies in which they are based. They sought structures which are intuitive and encourage skepticism of formal approaches and universalistic comparisons. Postmodernist, post-structuralist, feminist, and Marxist approaches all amplify this through their emphasis on the relation between the culture of the anthropologist and the culture of the informant, and more particularly on the relationship between anthropologist and informant as people, each with their own understanding of the other. Anthropological theory has a complex history, but its structure can be seen through the influences of individuals, the interplay within and between national traditions, and the development of the new focus of interest, new ideas from within and from beyond anthropology itself, and every few decades, new grand perspectives. Thank you.